Welcome to Commander Central episode 217, and today we're going to look at targeted land removal. I'm Dana.
I'm Max.
And I'm Chris.
Boys, welcome back. How's it going?
Howdy, howdy.
Another day in paradise.
Recording on a Friday, but at least it's nice out. We have the weekend ahead of us, so that's something.
That's true.
That's very true.
And we are probably not far away from Zendikar Rising spoilers, so that whole cycle is ready to kick back up again.
Didn't we just get done with previews?
It never ends, basically. From March till the end of September, it's, you know, basically one thing a month. And if you figure, you know, a 2 week or 3 week spoiler season, it's just nonstop.
Right.
So I just got the couple cards I wanted in from Double Masters. So I guess I'm ready.
I'm really happy you didn't say like jump start. So like you're only, you know, you're current with sets. You're not like one behind right. Like me.
I am mostly caught up. And I did build a new deck, or at least I ordered the last couple of cards I need for it that will hopefully be here next week-ish. The mail's running kind of slow, so I do have a new deck. I'd have to get a few reps on it before I talk too much about it, but I'm looking forward to trying that out as well. So I'm staying busy in terms of Magic stuff. How about you guys?
I built my Gumball deck, finally.
Oh yeah, so why don't you explain briefly what that is here?
Okay, so the Gumball challenge that our patrons and I guess the Canadian supporters are doing together. It's a deck where you pick typically a super powerful commander, Zavala, Urza, but anything will do. But then the rest of the deck has to be common or uncommon cards. And no card can be over 25 cents American.
So it's a strong commander with a super budget deck around it.
Super budget deck, so it can't be inherently broken, is what my guess is.
Okay, and you're very much leaning into it. And lands are included in this as well. Yeah. So like your land base is pretty limited as well.
Very limited. You can't even run snow lands because they're more than 25 cents. So
oh, sure.
It's interesting. You know, you don't get shocks, you don't get fetches, you don't get any normal land that I just am so accustomed to putting into my deck because
right.
You just put it in your deck.
Well, what did you wind up building, or are you not ready to reveal
I,
that
I
just
can
yet?
Reveal it. I ended up building Valduk.
Okay, and Matt Morgan has a non-Gumball version of that, but that's a really decent commander, and your mana base is much easier going monocolor.
Yeah, you know, I picked it because it's going to play a lot like Tuvasa, I think, where I just want to suit it up and go, and then hope I can be faster than everybody else in my pod.
Nice. So when is this actually going down?
I think we're going to try to get some people playing games this coming weekend at Command Fest Online, and then I think we're going to try to do it another weekend in the near future. I'm not in charge of scheduling anything. I just have to show up.
Nice. I'm definitely going to be doing some stuff for Command Fest Online, and I think you are too. Were you going to try that, Chris, or do you not have a webcam currently?
Do not have a webcam.
We should see if we can remedy that for him in the fairly near future as well. So we will look into that so we can maybe get a few games with you and with listeners as well, Chris. So we'll see if we can get that fixed here in the coming week so you can play a few virtual games as well.
I haven't played in so long, so I'm going to warn everyone, no mercy.
Well, you know, it's interesting, that is definitely something that happens when you don't play a lot in person, and it changes a little bit how you view the board state, too. Like, it's really easy to kind of miss, to, like, forget about Planeswalkers is one thing I've really noticed. Mm. That Planeswalkers ult on me in ways I normally wouldn't have allowed in an in-person game, but you kind of forget about them or because it's just, I don't know what it is, but it's a different experience for sure. But it's better than not playing.
That's true.
Yeah.
I mean, you can kind of be, you know, a little more aggressive. I feel like that Chris might be because no, you're not sitting in front of anybody. You know, it's kind of harder right. To read the room.
Yeah. Yeah. True. It's different. You also, though, you know, you get out of your bubble a little bit more than you usually do if you're just playing the shop every week, too. If you're playing with people from all over the place, that's been, I mean, it's nice to play with new people just in general, but like looking at it from a strategic perspective of deck building, it's also a good thing to actually see different metas and different environments and different deck building styles, because it's pretty easy to fall into a rut if you're playing with the same small group of people, you know, in your house on the weekends or even in a shop. I mean, we've got a pretty good group of people that play Commander in our shop. That's still 20 some people, and after a while you kind of see the same things and everyone kind of builds the same way to a degree, so it's good to shake that up too. If you out there in the listener land would like to reach out to us and talk about any of your virtual EDH experiences or basically anything else that's happening in the world of Magic, how would you do that, Chris?
You can find us on a multitude of social media platforms. We'll start off on Twitter, where you can find us at CMDR Central. You can search us up on Facebook, CMDR Central, and you can find us online at cmdrcentral.com.
You can also find us over on patreon.com/cmdrcentral, where you can check out our reward tiers. And if you're able to support us financially, that goes a long way to us keeping the lights on. I guess since we don't record together, I don't have to wear pants, but we'll find something else I can wear for our listeners.
Because my sister is stopping by here to pick up something at my house in the fairly near future, I have pants on today, but they are pajama pants. So kind of split the difference.
That's fair. But we want to say thank you and shout out to the following new patrons that have joined in the last week. So we want to say thank you to Nick, Josh Grimm, Ariel, Al Roscoe, Joshua Swoop, and George Mead.
Thank you all very much for supporting the show. We really appreciate it. It means a lot. And that is true of Patreon supporters as well as people that just support us by listening and upvoting and clicking that like button. That helps as well. All the support makes a big difference, and we appreciate it from everyone. I actually last night was watching a little bit of TV as I was packaging up some of our Planeswalker cards we'll be sending out here at the end of the month to patron supporters. So I got about 30 set into top loaders, and I'm still waiting for the envelopes that I ordered to show up. But that process is well on its way. So end of the month, we can start getting those sent out here to supporters, and you can get your own Max, Chris, and or Dana Planeswalker card. So I'm looking forward to getting those people's hands as well. All right, guys, should we jump into the main topic here?
Why not?
Sounds like a plan.
All righty. So there's a lot of lands in Commander that are a problem, and if you let them stick on the board, you're going to lose the game. And, you know, Mass Land Destruction is a whole different deal. That's more about a strategy where you have some kind of advantage. Say Archangel Avacyn is out and you're blowing up lands because yours won't get blown up, or you're playing Super Friends and it doesn't really hurt you as much as hurts everybody else, whatever. This is different. We're talking about targeted land removal, ways to deal with those lands that are big problems, and we wanted to talk about the best ways to do that. Maybe before we jump into that, though, let's talk about maybe some of the lands that are a problem. Are there any particular ones that jump out at you guys that when you see, you're like, I have to deal with that or we're going to lose? Which ones kind of jump out to you guys, Max?
Islands. You here. Islands. Every time.
I mean, I, to a degree, I've been in that situation where you're like, technically, if I blow up that island right now, the person can't cast a counterspell and I need to land this. You know, that doesn't happen very frequently, but
no.
Sure, I've thought that before.
But seriously, I mean, Gaia's Cradle, Sarah's Sanctum, Urborg, or even Cabal Coffers are some of that just jumped to my top of my head right away.
You know, Cabal Stronghold isn't as good as Cabal Coffers, but like I've been in situations where I'm like, Cabal Stronghold's making 7 mana a turn. I can't let that sit. Nykthos is crazy. And it's easy to forget because, or not forget, but like you don't think in terms of how busted it is because Cabal Coffers is so crazy and Guy's Cradle is so crazy. But like Nykthos can be just nuts as well. That's one I feel like you have to get rid of. There's sometimes, you know, you're just dead if you can't get rid of that Glacial Chasm. That needs to be gone as well. I actually, on the EDH Rec cast stream last week, killed 2 different people with Valkut.
Ooh.
You know, there's times when, like, Index, when if that's out, that you're just going to get screwed too. So there's a lot of them in the game. And that's not even getting into, like, the flip lands from Ixalan that do a lot of the same thing as some of the busted ones we've just talked about. So there's a lot of good ones out there. Luckily, now that Gaia's Cradle costs, I think it's $22,000 for a copy of Gaia's Cradle, you won't be having to deal with that nearly as much as you maybe once did. But
is it seriously gone up in price?
It's, I think I saw Star City Games was buy listing them for $600.
Oh.
That why? Was their buy list.
Why? No one plays Legacy anymore. The card should only be like $30.
I don't know. It's insane. So,
Chris, I will draw you a very, very nice homemade Gaia's Cradle for $30.
I mean, jeez. maybe that kind of thing will, you know, force them to make more Itlamok style, you know, not quite Gaia's Cradle level lands that they can that do a similar thing to get them in people's hands, just because the actual versions are just unaffordable for most people. So who knows?
That would be awesome.
But there's definitely ones out there that have to get dealt with. So I think the easiest way, the most common way you see people prep to deal with busted lands in Commander is with other lands. You know, starting way back in Antiquities with Strip Mine, they've been printing lands that blow up lands. I think that's probably the easiest way to do it for the most part. So why don't we go over the lands that deal with lands?
Okay. So like you just mentioned, Dana, we're going to start with Strip Mine. It has no activation cost. It's only one of three with no cost to actually hit another land to destroy it. It can hit all lands, so basics and non-basics. It's in almost 36,000 decks on EDHREC. And unfortunately, because it's so old, the cheapest version is like $20, and I think that's the From the Vault version.
From the Vault, and I think maybe the Chronicles one as well is roughly around that price.
Oof.
I remember, though, like when we first started getting into Magic, or getting into Commander, this was a $3-ish dollar card. Because I was like...
Because it's banned in Legacy.
Yeah, I mean, it wasn't playable anywhere else. And there was multiple printings, you know, the ugly white-bordered one from Chronicles. I think the Antiquities one was generally a little more expensive, but, like, you could get the 4th edition one or the Chronicles one relatively cheaply, and it was just assumed you put a strip mine in your deck because it was, you know, it was the price of a cup of coffee, so you just grab one, put it in your deck, and that was it. I had them stockpiled because when I would see one in a collection, I'd just grab it and throw it in, you know, my stack of stuff that I knew I would one day use for EDH. So it kind of gets easy to take it for granted that everyone can put a strip mine in their deck, but it's no longer $3. It's 20-some bucks, and that gets much tougher to run than it is when it was three. So it's great, but it's no longer an easy thing to just throw into a deck.
That's true. That's why we run another card. How about the Ghost Quarter? Very similar to Strip Mine with no activation cost. I can hit basics as well as non-basics. Man, this is just like Strip Mine almost. But the downside to it is that it lets the controller of the land that gets destroyed to search for a basic land card and put it in the battlefield tapped. It is a may effect, so you don't have to, you know, because sometimes you have your top of your deck stack, so you don't want to shuffle that or anything. There are 33,000 decks on EDHREC that run this, and this card, compared to the Strip Mine at the $20, this card is at 60 cents. So much, much easier to get your hands on. And I do believe this thing has way, way more printings as well.
What's funny about this is talking about the pricing on Strip Mine. There was a point in time when I was putting Strip Mines in all my decks because it was $3 when Ghost Quarter was more expensive than Strip Mine.
Yep.
Because the only printing had been in the original Ravnica set. I think it was reprinted in...
Innistrad.
Innistrad. But like before that Innistrad reprinting, it was, I believe, more expensive than Strip Mine.
Yeah, I think the big reprinting was when they did that Modern Event deck. I think that's when it got the big reprinting, and then ever since then it's like every Commander set that's been printed since then has always had a Ghost Quarter of some sort in it.
Yeah.
And another kind of cool thing about this too, I remember watching Legacy streams and seeing someone play Ghost Quarter and thinking to myself, well, that's strange, why are they not playing, you know, Wasteland or something else, Ghost Quartering someone's land, and the person doing the fail to find, you know, they take the free shuffle, but they didn't have basics to go get.
Yep.
And I was like, oh my god, it's just a second strip mine.
Yep. And they're forcing them to shuffle because, like in Legacy, there was a lot of decks like you brainstorm or you're playing, sure, Miracles or something, and you're stacking the top of your deck up, and it's like, oh, I'm just gonna force you to shuffle all that stuff away because I don't want to deal with it.
Or at least force them to make the choice.
Yep.
Yeah, this, you know, super, super cool card. In Commander, you very rarely are going to encounter a situation where someone's not gonna have a basic unless they're playing, you know, something with Hermit Druid, but
the traitor,
right? And they do it. It is a may, like you mentioned, but Ghost Quarter is still really, really good, especially at that price.
Yep. I think the best part about it is that it hits every land, so
everything, you bet.
Even if you do hit a basic, I mean, sometimes you're like, you're watching someone, they're playing a five color deck, and it's like, oh, that mountain right there, I'm gonna destroy that mountain because red's usually the weakest color in five colors. It's like, oh, you don't have another mountain in there, haha.
And I don't really do, like, I'm not usually looking to do mana denial. However, that's when I would do it. If it's a situation where, like, oh, someone's sitting on, you know, 11 lands and they're going to cast, you know, Ulamog next turn or something, I would absolutely do it then. I remember I've done it in the past for, we had a guy we used to play with who played a Thraxamundar deck a lot. And you'd look down, like, I only have one blocker. And if Thraxamundar comes down, I'm going to have to sacrifice it and then get hit for, you know, seven.
Yep.
I'm just going to hit that one land so Thrax can't come down this turn and buy myself enough time to get, you know, two chump blockers out or something. So yeah, it absolutely is. The ability to hit a basic is very, very useful. So The next one we have here, and these are in sequence in how popular they are in EDHRec. Ghost Quarter is just behind Strip Mine. And then we have a bit of a jump down to Field of Ruin, although that's the newest one here on the list.
Sure is from Ixalan, I do believe, was its original printing.
And unlike those two, it does have a 2-mana activation cost, so you do have to put mana into using it. So it's a little bit more difficult to like just leave up for an emergency, because you would have to leave some other mana up to use it. It also only hits non-basics, but the caveat here is after you destroy a land, each player searches for a basic land card, each player, and puts it into play untapped, and then shuffles. This isn't a May effect either. There's no choice here. So this gives you the added ability. You know, sometimes with Ghost Quarter, you have to put them in a position where they have to choose between the shuffle or not. And if someone just like Vamp Tutors, odds are they're just not going to go get the land. They don't have a choice with Field of Ruin. If somebody Vamp Tutors and you Field of Ruin, and in response to the resolution of the spell, they just lose the Vamp Tutor.
This card is also one that you need to be careful with, because every player in the pod gets to search for land.
Now, the math on that, that sounds worse than it is. So, you know, let's say everyone in your pod is at 5 lands. If you strip mine someone's land, then you and that player both go to 4.
Yep.
The other players are still at 5. In Field of Ruin, in the same situation, if you use your Field of Ruin and destroy a land, then you and the person you hit stay at 5 and everyone else goes to 6. So the differential between lands, between players, stays the same as it is with Strip Mine. However, it is more complicated than that, because you don't know, have you just solved someone else's fixed mana problem, right? If you use this, and the third party who wasn't involved in the exchange is like, well, perfect. I didn't have a forest, and I just got my forest. So like, they're absolutely, it's not a perfect one-for-one thing with Strip Mine, where you're going up a land instead of going down a land. There are other things involved. You know, someone just, Sylvan Library, they're like, oh man, I have, you know, 2 lands on top, but I don't want to pay the life. You Field of Ruin, they're like, sweet, free shuffle.
Yep.
So it's not as innocuous as it seems. It's also 70 cents. And if you don't want to spend $20 on a strip mine, I don't feel like that's a huge downgrade. I would be perfectly comfortable running Field of Ruin in a budget-ish deck if I didn't have the money to spend on a strip mine. I wouldn't feel bad about it at all.
Yeah, well, the upside to Field of Ruin, too, is that it replaces itself for you.
You bet.
So, I mean, you're not really out anything doing it. It's just hopefully you use it right and you hit someone else's horrible card, so they're out of that. But then you're just like, cool, it's just going to replace itself.
And, you know, we did mention this, but I'll say it again. There will be a point in time when someone forgets that you have Field of Ruin out, and they do an Enlightened Tutor or a Vamp Tutor or something, and you're like, gotcha. So
you forget that it's out, and you're like, right. Oh no.
For sure. That doesn't bring good memories to my mind, Dana. Let's not talk about that.
Well, why don't we skip to the next one here, Max?
Next one on the list is Wasteland. This is the final one with no activation cost to activate. It only hits non-basics, though, so it's not going to hit that forest, but it will hit Nykthos, which is probably the better target anyways.
Yes.
It's in just over 14,000 decks on EDHREC, and the cheapest version is $26. So, I mean, it's up there with Strip Mine, and that's pretty cheap. I think I've seen it way more expensive in the past.
When we first started playing, back when Strip Mine was $3, this was over 80.
Mm-hmm.
And part of the reason I recall that was because Force of Will was around 80 at the same time. And I had found a collection that had multiple Wastelands in it, and I traded 2 Wastelands for 2 Force of Wills.
Yep. This was also when we started playing. It never had a reprint. It was only in, I think it was Tempest or something like that, somewhere around in there.
I believe so, yeah.
And then since then, it's had 3 reprints, I think is what we're at now.
Yeah. So it's much more affordable. It's not on the strip. I mean, it's still not cheap, but like, it's much easier to pick up a Wasteland at $20-some, $25-ish, than it is to pick up a Wasteland when it was at 80. It's still a good bit of money, but it's a little bit more affordable at least. And this is one I bet we'll also see future reprints and eventually wind up as a, you know, $10-ish card.
Well, yeah, this is also a card because, I mean, Legacy is still a format to be played. Yes, Star City Games doesn't support it, but other places support it. Local shops support it. Wizard still kind of supports it. So with this card being the only good legal card that can destroy lands in Legacy, they're going to reprint it so people play Legacy.
Yeah, and I think before I misspoke when I said, why did they not use Strip Mine? I think I meant Vintage or whatever. Regardless, talking about Ghost Quarter, you're right.
Yep.
Strip Mine's not legal anywhere. Wasteland is the one that you can run in those formats.
Oh, and it's very boring to watch, too. I've watched games on stream where it's turn one guy plays a Wasteland. The next guy goes, he plays a Wasteland. You're like, oh God, we're going to do one of these numbers and watch these guys just wasteland each other.
Yep. Someone plays a Richard in port and you're like, oh no.
Yep. So after we talked about Wasteland, how about we jump over to the next one, which is Tectonic Edge. Now, Tectonic Edge has a one colorless mana activation cost. It only hits non-basics, but on the downside to this, it can only do that if your opponents control four or more lands. It's in just over 9,500 decks on EDHRec, and this card is only like 50 cents. I do see this card actually a lot in Modern for some reason, and I'm not sure why it's being played over like Ghost Quarter, aside from the fact that you get lands, but... I mean, 60 cents is 60 cents. I ain't ever going to complain about that.
You know, I run this in a couple of different decks, and I don't know if I have a preference necessarily over Ghost Quarter. They both have their pros and their cons. I think it tends to be a situation where if I have a Tectonic Edge, that when I built that deck, I put Tech Edge in. If I have a Ghost Quarter, I think I put Ghost Quarter in. That's my math.
The upside to this card too, I don't know the exact pricing on it, but I know before the Rona swept through our country and the world, the Tech Edge, what is it, Expedition or whatever, the Masterpiece version of it,
yep,
was only like a $30 card. So if you wanted a really, really fancy land or something like that, it wasn't that expensive to get a hold of.
You bet. Good looking card too, and very reasonable.
According to Scryfall, it's like $23 on TCG Player.
Oh, even better.
And it had an FNM printing, and it was in a few Commander decks. And yeah, it's had enough printings that you can either get that cool-looking one for still a good price, or get the cheap budget version and still a solid card. And, you know, the four or more lands thing is a big deal, maybe in a competitive format. For the most part, in Commander, you're not trying to deny someone lands in the first couple turns.
No.
Unless you're playing competitively. If your primary concern is hitting a guy's cradle, which isn't going to be particularly good usually in the first three or four turns anyway, then it's just a perfectly good way to deal with problem lands.
Yeah. I mean, and the upside to this too is this is one of those that you play that people aren't going to get all fussy with you, because you can only target non-basics.
Only target non-basics, and you can't do it in the first couple turns.
Yep.
So absolutely, nobody usually gets mad here. Up next here, we have Dust Bowl.
That's an old one.
Yeah. 3 mana activation cost here, so it's kind of pricey because you're using the land itself, so basically it winds up costing you 4 mana. It only hits non-basics, but the cool thing about Dust Bowl, unlike the rest of these lands, Dust Bowl doesn't sacrifice itself. You have to sacrifice a land, but you can sacrifice any land you have to blow up the land you're targeting. So sacrifice a forest and pay the activation cost, and you still have the Dust Bowl sitting there to be used if you need to use it later on. So it's in about 3,500 decks in EDHRec. It also had a pretty good looking Expedition printing a couple years back that was reasonably priced, although I think it's drifted up a little bit. It's probably closer to 40 now than it was. And it hasn't had a ton of printings. It's $7 or $8 to get the regular version. But it's a pretty playable card. It's not the kind of thing where like I put Dust Bowl in all of my decks, but I run it in at least one, if not two currently. Ones particularly that have some recursion or tend to be able to ramp out lands, because then I don't feel as bad about sacrificing a spare land and then still have Dust Bowl there just in case someone plays something else the next turn I want to deal with.
Yeah, it is very surprising that more people don't play it. I mean, you would think in a heavy ramp deck or something that's playing a lot of mana rocks or something, this card could be key in the end of the game. You know, like, okay, that land's a problem, that land's a problem, that land's a problem. Let's just get rid of them on every chance I can.
And if you're playing in a deck that has Crucible Worlds or has Excavator, you know, it's so much easier to then just recur that thing. I guess the same thing is true of Strip Mine or something, but it's being able to bring the lands back after you use them is pretty useful in Dust Bowl.
Yep.
So it's one I like and do it in a few different places.
Yeah. And it also doesn't say that the land has to be untapped to sack it. So
right,
I mean, you could float the mana and then blow something up and be like, oh, well, now I got this mana floating too.
Or if you're playing like one of those, if you're running a deck that has some of those, like it's a vivid land that you've taken counters off, or any of the things with depletion counters or something where like the land ceases to be useful after a while, or even something like Llanowar Reborn, which is a land that comes into play with a graph counter on it that you can then move off to a creature, well, sacrifice that to Dust Bowl to blow up someone's land. And then you can replay it to get that counter back, or reuse your Bajuka Bog or whatever. Like there's a couple different things you could find useful for this if you have some land recursion as ways to reuse those lands that have some kind of an ability on them that you can only use a couple times.
Yeah, it's definitely a good tip for people who are, you know, look at your deck, and if you're recurring stuff, this is definitely a card that could go right in and it wouldn't hurt you at all. And you'd probably be surprised at how useful it's going to become to you.
For sure. So those are the real good ones, but there are two more we might as well
mention. The real good ones.
The real good ones. At least those are the ones, like, I would say myself, I would play any of those six, whereas the other two that destroy lands, I don't think maybe make the cut, but we might as well mention them here. So what's the first one here, Max?
The first one would be Encroaching Wastes. This taps for a colorless, and it also has a 4-mana activation cost to sacrifice it, and you destroy a non-basic land. It's only in 2,300 decks on EDHREC, and it's like a quarter. 4 mana to end sacrificing it is just, that's a lot to ask for when you have 6 other better options, like Dana just said.
Even on a budget.
Right.
I mean, like, the fact is, Ghost Quarter is under $1, Field of Ruins under $1, Tectonic Edge is under $1. So even on a budget, I just don't feel like this is probably worth it.
So my curiosity on this is, so 2,300 decks, I wonder if these are all, like, colorless decks.
They could be.
You know what? That's a good point.
If you're going to run an all-colorless deck, you might as well play every land possible that could have an ability on it, you know, that could help you at some point or another.
No, that's a real good point. I never thought of that, but yeah, that would make sense. Because like I said, on a budget, it doesn't make sense unless you want to have 5 or 6 of these lands in your deck. But no, that's a good call.
Yeah.
Because it is a colorless source, and if you don't want to run wastes, yeah, I get it.
Maybe they're all playing Gumball. That's what it is.
There we go.
too expensive. Chris, you are right. Majority of the top commanders for this card are all the Eldrazi's, a couple artifact creatures, and then Titania, of course, because stuff. Yep.
Let's recur all these lands and not care.
Yeah, good catch.
Yep.
What's the last one here, Chris?
Do I have to talk about this one? And why did I get shafted with the red card?
Because you're the red mage, like, on the show.
Right? And I don't even play this card. So we're going to talk about Memorial to War. This is I don't even remember. This came out of Zendikar or something like that, I do believe. Somewhere around in there.
I think it was in Domino, the Dominaria set. Yeah.
Was it?
Ugh. Yeah.
Even worse. Okay. It has a 4 and a red activation cost to sacrifice this land. It can hit basics like Strip Mine and Ghost Quarter, so I mean, has a little bit of an upside, but this land enters tapped, and it's the only one that can tap for colored mana. So I mean, I suppose it does have some sort of upsides to it, but as everyone on EDHREC has shown, it's only in like 1,400 decks, so it is not good, even though it is less than a dime to go buy one.
I mean, Max could run this in his Gumball deck.
I very well could. I probably won't.
I would, to see what people say.
It comes in tapped. I can't afford the speed hiccup there.
I mean, did this even see standard play at the time?
Probably not.
Because so if this was Dominaria, it would have been the blue one, Memorial to Genius or whatever, would have been the only one that was played, because you could sack it to draw 2 lands or draw 2 cards for, I think it was like the same activation cost. So
yeah, I don't recall ever seeing this. It taps for red, I guess. But again, in Commander, you just have access to so many different dual lands. I just can't imagine it's worth it coming into play tapped and having to spend 5 mana plus itself, technically 6 mana to hit 1 land. I wouldn't be running it, particularly when there's other options available that are relatively cheap.
Yeah, no, if you're on budget, like the decks have to be within a certain budget, I could see it. If you're playing with the new people to show them like weird interactions with cards, I could see it, because it's not like, oh, here's a strip mine, I'm just going to kill your thing right now. It's like, nope, this, I have to do all of this to put this into this to destroy that. But hey, you know what? These cards are better for future reference for you, type of deal.
All right, so we've looked at the lands. I will add a couple of questions I'll quick ask you guys here. Do you run some kind of a land removal in every single deck? And if so, how many do you run? Is there some kind of a rule you use, or do you just play it by ear? And Max, start with you.
I run at least one in all of my decks, minus the Gumball deck, because I don't want to run Memorial to War. But yeah, I run at least one in every deck, and majority of the cards I do run are either Strip Mine or Ghost Quarter, just because I have the copies.
Sure.
I don't really want to go buying another Strip Mine, so maybe I'll start going to Ghost Quarter and Field of Ruin. But yeah, I try to at least put one in every deck, and depending on how the deck plays, it determines if I want that second one in the deck.
How about you, Chris?
It all depends on the color combination of the deck. Like, if you're running 3 or 4 colors, I have to minimize the amount of colorless lands I play.
You bet.
But in my, like, 2-color decks, I run 2 to 3 of these. Like, it's nothing. It's like, no, Ghost Quarter goes in, Field of Ruin goes in. If I have an extra strip mine, it goes in. And those are the 3 that I start with. And then after that, you start looking at the other ones. And, like, Tech Edge, it's like, could this go in? Would this be okay? I don't know. All that fun stuff.
Yeah, I'm kind of similar to you, Chris. In one or two color decks, I tend to try to get three in. I believe all of my one and two color decks have three different land removal lands. My three color Kresh deck, I think, has two, and my five color Kenrith deck has two, I think, if I remember correctly. Just because I would rather pull something else out for a utility land. I feel like they're just too useful. But you're right, it gets tricky once you get into three, four, five colors to have those colorless lands in there for sure.
Yeah, well, that's why, I mean, if you're on a multiple colors, you start running the colored spells that can do the stuff for you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right. Well, which is what we're going to jump into next. And these are ones that also hit lands. We'll talk briefly, I think, at the end about ones that just hit lands. But these are spells that basically let you destroy or occasionally exile a permanent. Not a non-land permanent, just a permanent. So let me go over the first half of this list here, Chris. We can just read them off briefly.
Okay. I'm going to read these off, and I'm going to say a number after them. The number after them is the amount of decks on EDHREC that these are being played in, just for everyone's reference, so I can quickly get through them. We have Angel of Despair, which is at 3,800. Archon of Justice, which is at 2,500. Ashen Rider, which is at 3,300. Assassin's Trophy, which is at 21,000. Beast Within, which is at 69,000. Bramble Crash, which is only 1,000. Desert Twister is 1,000. Generous Gift, which is 22,000. And Karn Liberated, due to his -3 ability, which is at 5,000.
In the other half of this list, we have Lux Cannon at 2,100. Mangar of Karandor? Sure.
Yep. The first Mangara card.
At 2,200. Nicol Bolas Planeswalker, his +1 ability at 5,100. Scour from Existence at 6,100. Spine of Ishshaw at 8,700. Terastodon at 17,000. Ulamog Ceaseless Hunger at 11,000. Unstable Obelisk at 8,800. Vindicate at 12,000. And Violent Ultimatum at 900 decks.
Hmm. I'm going to put this list together, and it's possible I missed some. I did a Scryfall search, but like the wording syntax gets a little bit weird sometimes. So it's possible I missed some. And I dropped anything off the list that was under 900 decks. So there's probably a couple more like, well, why isn't no one running? Whatever. Angelic Edict, I think, hits, and it was in 76 decks or something. So that's, I didn't even put it on the list. So I tried to stick to ones that people tended to actually run. What's nice about these is it's kind of similar to the land removal lands. The land removal lands, even if nobody plays a good land, you can still tap it for mana. They're just always useful. The same is kind of true here. If you don't need to destroy a land with Beast Within, say, it still hits everything else. Like they're still useful removal spells, even if lands aren't a problem. So that's that added utility is really, really nice. Which ones on this list of these do you guys tend to play or like the most?
It's actually a good question. I'm actually looking at the list right now, and a lot of these I do not play. I mean, aside from like Ulamog, Generous Gift, I mean, that kind of stuff, but like I don't play the green color, so like Beast Within and Assassin's Trophy, which I would be playing if I played green. Otherwise, the rest of them, I really don't play any of these, because I try to focus more on the lands, because it's more utility when I can still cast the other spells to do something different.
Sure. How about you, Max?
Yeah, I'm kind of in the same boat as Chris. I mean, I play green, but I really only play the Beast Within, the Generous Gifts, and that's it. I mean, I don't run Vindicate. I don't play Ulamog or Terastodon. I used to run Spine in Brago years ago, and that was a way to loop, you know, blowing up everybody's lands, essentially. But yeah, those are really the only two on this list that I run consistently in all my decks would be Beast Within and Generous Gift.
You know, I'm kind of in a similar boat. I think if I'm playing green, I probably have a Beast Within in it, just because it hits every single target. It's really tough to pass that up. Same with Generous Gift, since that's been out. The fact that it can just deal with any problem makes it really tough not to run. Assassin's Trophy, same thing. If I have access to black and green, the fact that it's a two-mana spell that can solve any problem, that's amazing. So those three for sure, I think I tend to run. If I'm playing, I have a five-color deck that isn't running Vindicate, but it is in my two-color deck. It's one that I could see myself pulling out, though, especially because that deck does have Generous Gift already, and it has the land removal land. So, like, I wouldn't feel too bad replacing Vindicate with, you know, the next variant on Anguished Unmaking that came out or something. If it was, like, an instant speed one that didn't hit lands, I'd be probably willing to pull it, because instant speed's so much useful in Vindicate, at a sorcery speed kind of is unfortunate. So that one I might take out at some point, but I do still run it in my Orzhov deck. The rest I really don't, though. Like, I know there are people that are like, oh, I put Angel of Despair in all my black-white decks because it hits something coming in and something going out. Or Ashen Rider, I guess, is one that hits it on both ways. But I don't know. That's a lot of mana for a removal spell that happens to be attached to an Angel. I think it's not bad. Same with Trastodon. Trastodon's a great card, but like, I just never want to put something that costs that much mana into a green deck as a removal spell, I guess, unless it has some kind of added utility.
Yeah, you'd rather have the big giant that comes in and destroys all enchantments or whatever over the Trastodon type of deal.
Yeah, and Trastodon sees a ton of plays and 17,000 decks, but it's just not, it's not how I tend to build.
Well, I mean, I suppose if you're playing mono green and you're not like limiting yourself like you are with legends or whatever in the one deck, it is a 9/9 beater. I mean, it could come out and you can blow up your stuff and get the 3/3 guys and be like, wah-ha-ha-ha.
Right, you know, if you have haste on board from something and you drop this and you're like, well, I'm gonna alpha strike somebody right now because I've got a, you know, Beastmaster Ascension out, well, I'll blow up three of my lands and mow somebody down because it's gonna just be a game ending board state. Sure, you bet. Yep. That's some good utility.
So I was looking at this list, and one card that I was thinking about that I always think about when I play green and land destruction is Acidic Slime. And, you know, it hits lands, artifacts, and enchantments on enter the battlefield. How often do you really think people are using it for the land removal versus taking out a Doubling Season or a Chroma's Memorial or something like that?
Well, first of all, this number one definitely should be on the list. It must have got omitted. Something in my search syntax just didn't hit it. Or my brain just, or I just skipped past it mentally when I was writing cards down. So that's definitely a mistake on my part. You know, I run it in my Glissa deck, and I've had it in that deck since the beginning. So, like, we're looking at 7 years of having this card in one deck. I'm trying to think. I'm sure I've used it to blow up someone's land at some point in time. But I can't think of a situation off the top of my head where I've done it at least recently. I'm sure I've done it, but I don't recall doing it. I don't know why that is either.
I'm sure it goes for all the cards on this list. I mean, a lot of them, like, I'm looking at Scour from Existence, for example. I mean, it's in 6,000 decks. It's probably in decks that lack the ability to destroy enchantments and or artifacts, and that's why it's in there.
Yeah.
What I would guess the reasoning is I feel like Acidic Slime, I shouldn't say most people, but definitely me, when I play it, it's usually a situation where I draw it and I'm looking at the board side being like, okay, what's the biggest threat that Acidic Slime can hit? Because there's almost always an artifact or enchantment in play that's a problem. So you tend to just use it to deal with the biggest problem in play.
Yeah.
Whereas your strip mine sits there until there's a problem land. Like, you don't usually blow strip mine unless it's a life or death situation. Whereas I feel like you maybe tend to use Acidic Slime on a value target versus saving it for that, oh my god, someone just played a cradle. Glad I held on to my Acidic Slime.
Yeah, that makes sense.
But that's probably a good point, though, about all of these to a degree. I think you, particularly the ones attached to creatures, I would guess people tend to play them as value plays to hit the strongest thing on the board versus holding on to them for a problem.
Well, I think that's because land destruction in general is just a taboo subject in Commander.
Yeah, for sure, it can be.
Everyone gets upset about it, so a lot of people don't even think about destroying the land. They're more worried about the other permanents on the battlefield.
Yeah.
So lands just go unnoticed unless it's like strip mine, where you're like, oh, well, this can only destroy a land. So I guess this card's okay because everyone's deemed it okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Although I would say this, if you're playing a Gaia's Cradle, you should not be salty when someone's like, I'm removing it. That should not bother you.
You should
understand why that happened.
I'd be like, I paid $600 for this. You should let it sit on the table.
That Gaia's Cradle costs as much as 4 years of college. How dare you? Or, you know, not today, but like by the time the show airs in 3 days, it'll probably well have gone up that much. So. If trends are any indication of where it's heading. So the last ones here we'll talk about just briefly, because I don't run them. I don't know if I've ever seen one cast. Are the spells that just destroy lands? And what's notable about those is we had three of them back in Alpha. We had Stone Rain in red that's seen quite a few reprints since then. We had Sinkhole in black that didn't make it past Unlimited. And I don't think it had a reprint until a Master set a couple years back.
Yep.
And Ice Storm in green that also destroyed a target land that I I don't know if it's had a reprint at all outside.
That was in like a portal or something, wasn't it?
Was it? It might have been.
I don't remember where it was, but I know it's a really old set.
So those were in the game very early on, but I don't run any of them. Do you guys run any of those spells that like just targeted destroy single land?
No, I don't run targeted destroy single land. I wanted to talk about one that I do run that okay. I deem as a targeted, even though it's technically mass, and that's Ruination, because it only targets non-basic.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it may destroy all of them, but it's still a targeted type of spell that's not, you know, just saying, hey, I'm a cheese ball, I'm destroying everything. It's just like, no, you know, this is getting out of control. Let's just play the basic game.
Well, I don't think anyone's like, uh-oh, someone played a Nykthos, I better cast Armageddon. Yep. But for sure, I would bet that it makes sense to hold on to a Ruination to cast it once you see something particularly problematic in play.
Exactly.
That makes sense.
I mean, because there's now, would you guys consider, let's say, like Blood Moon, would you consider that a targeted thing?
No,
not really. No, but I also don't consider it mass land destruction, because I feel like, number one, if you get rid of it, everything goes back to where it was.
Yep.
And number two, I don't think it's too difficult. Like it can be very difficult to build with Armageddon in mind.
Yeah.
I don't think, outside of five color decks, you should be able to run enough basics to survive when a Blood Moon comes down for the most part.
Yep.
Yeah. I mean, back in the day, I ran Monvuli Acid Moss. It's a 4-mana sorcery out of Time Spiral that destroys a target land, but you get to search your library for a forest card and put it on the battlefield tapped. So it replaces itself, you know, because you get a land, but it at 4 mana, you know, this was back in the early days of me playing EDH. It's probably what I had versus a Cultivator or Kodama's Reach. So it eventually got cut, but I think I've really only ran that one in the past.
Yeah, I don't think this is a bad card by any means, neither, because it is a ramp spell. I would consider looking at this as a ramp spell where you get any forest. I mean, not just a basic, any forest.
Yeah.
If you're playing a two-color deck, you go for your dual land.
Exactly.
And you're limiting someone else. I mean, this card actually is not bad at all. I know I personally play it in Modern in the Scapeshift deck that I play with Primeval Titan and all that, you know, all that cheese ball fun stuff. But I mean, it's awesome to just blow something up like that, limit them from doing something, and then you gain something on top of it.
Yeah, particularly when it's you're playing your relatively inexpensive card and taking out that expensive Serra Sanctum or something. That always feels like a really great trade as well.
Yeah, because I mean, like a card like this, personally, if I looked at someone playing it against me, they're advancing the game. They're not just, you know, stalling the game out, whereas that's what Stone Rain does or other things like that. Because, like, I won for one you with a card out of my hand to destroy your land. But this is, I kill something, I gain something, so I'm getting way ahead of you to finish this game off.
For sure.
Yeah. I think it was right after Eternal Masters came out, somebody in the shop must have cracked a Sinkhole in one of their packs because they put it in a deck. And I remember seeing someone cast Sinkhole and thinking to myself, wow, then I had to like reframe it in my head. I'm like, is it good enough to run those? Because somebody ran it. And then I had to think of it. I'm like, no, it's just not. And the person then took it out. Like I never saw it again. So like they must have done the same thing. They got the Sinkhole, put it in deck, and then realized it's just not worth devoting a slot to Sinkhole.
No.
But, you know, that was a card that was also expensive for a long time because it didn't have a printing. I think there was a Judge printing 10 years ago or something. And then Eternal Masters was the first one in a long time. And then I checked Ice Storm, too. Ice Storm only had the Alpha Beta Unlimited printing.
Oh, was it only Alpha Beta Unlimited?
Okay. Yeah. So that's why we never see that one. I think it was Collector's Edition, too. That's why we never, ever see that one either. So, and there's a few. Red has gotten quite a few of them over the years that are like destroy a land, do 2 damage to a target or something. But the only time I see that kind of thing is if it's attached, if it's on a card that says destroy target land or artifact or enchantment or something, because there's a few of those out there. But yeah, I would agree. I don't think it's worth it running a spell that just hits lands, and I don't really see most people doing that, and I would be surprised if it was a good play if you were doing it. So
see, and that's where you run into the taboo subject, because you're playing a multiplayer game, so you, having single targeted is not as good as having mass. So
you
then
bet.
you start moving towards the mass stuff, because you're like, well, I want to hit everybody, and then it starts causing the issues.
Yeah. Well, and also, like, trading the Sinkhole for a land in a 1v1 game where the only two people in the game are losing something. You're losing mana, and you're losing a card, and they're losing a land.
Yep.
You're both being set back. In a 4-player game, the other two people aren't losing anything at all.
No, they just sit back and laugh and like,
yeah. Yeah. That's not saying it's not worthwhile doing sometimes, but like to have a thing that only hits a land just feels way, way worse than particularly when Beast Within exists or something along those lines. Yep. So any final thoughts here from you guys on targeted land removal?
I guess the big thing I want to say about this is most cards that destroy lands that are good have a very high upside to do many other things. So if you are worried about lands, look for the cards that can do more than one thing. So you're not limiting yourself to one narrow-minded focused thought, and you're wide open to do whatever as the game proceeds in whatever general direction it wants to go.
Yeah, I think that it should either do that or it should have no or have low opportunity cost. So like Strip Mine, if you don't use it, it comes into play untapped and it always makes you a colorless anyway. So there's like no cost to you essentially. Occasionally you'll get burned because you needed the colorless mana, but like by and large, if you don't use it, you haven't really paid a price. So it's one of those two things. Either have the card be fantastically useful, like you mentioned, so it's worth it, or have it cost you almost nothing at all if you don't use it.
Yeah,
it needs to be one of those two things.
I have definitely seen in games where someone plays a Strip Mine on like turn 3, and that Strip Mine will sit there till turn 12 before it's ever used.
Yeah.
But meanwhile, they've tapped it every turn, and it's not hurt them a bit to not use it for 9 turns. But I will say you just should pack these in your deck. They may not win you games, but they will keep you from losing games. For sure.
Oh, that is 100% true. I mean, I have seen, a couple of coffers come down and it just sits there and all of a sudden they go, oh, and now Urborg and now all of this and I double all this mana. And then you're like, oh, yeah, now I wish I had that land destruction land.
Yeah, makes it. Well, I mean, I talked about killing people with my Valkut the other night on the EDH Rec stream. Had someone been able to deal with that, that would have changed, because that was the main reason or the main way I was able to take. I think Joey had gained a good, he was down to like 4 life and then he got back up to like 15, and I was able to like play a fetch land because I had Dry to the Elysian Grove in play.
Ooh.
That made lands basic land types. So then I was able to like, because I could play multiple lands a turn, additionally because the Dryad, I could play a fetch land that did 3 to him, crack it to go get a land that comes into play that did 3 to him, play a second fetch land for my second land for turn that I cracked to go get a basic land, and then like played Kodama's Reach or something. So like I was able to rack up like 15 damage to him in a single turn with that. A single Strip Mine in play would have saved it.
Yep. I know back in the day when everyone was playing Tempt with the Discovery, it was definitely when I would take their Tempt up just to go for a land destruction land to deal with whatever they were going for.
Yeah. Right. If everyone at the table, like with a Tempt, if everyone goes and gets a Strip Mine, that's the best play usually, because then you're taking the lands out of their decks, basically, whatever ones they go grab. So, yeah. All right. I think that is going to wrap up episode 217. Thank you very much to my co-hosts. You can find the podcast on the interwebs at CMDR Central. You can find Max at CMDR_Central_Max. You can find Chris at YSquishy1. And you can find me at Dana Roach. Our podcast theme is Retro Future Dirty by Kevin McLeod. And our show was edited by Rafael Garcia, who is on Twitter at Ursa Bearwalker. Until next week, I'm Dana.
I'm Max.
And I'm Chris.